The world is a beautiful but challenging place to live. And let's face it, life hits hard sometimes. So if you find your hopes and dreams and mental well-being needs a boost, you're tuned in to the right podcast. Welcome to Inspire Us with your host, J. Paul Nadeau, a former hostage negotiator turned motivational speaker and best-selling author. And now, here's your host, J. Paul Nadeau. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Inspire Us with your host, me. Today, I'm going to throw on another Clubhouse special, Negotiating Your Way Out of Self-Sabotage, with some amazing moderators and some really interesting conversations. Some of the conversations revolve around identity and comparison to other people. We had a wonderful conversation between the moderators that you're absolutely going to love. So without any further delay, here's the July 9th, 2022 Clubhouse recording of Negotiating Your Way Out of Self-Sabotage.
Good morning, Michelle.
Good morning. Good morning, or yeah, it's still good morning. We've got 3 minutes.
Yes, we do. In some places it's the afternoon, and other places it's the evening, right?
'Tis true, but three till we start the room, and there's King.
Hello. How's everyone today?
Doing great.
Feeling fine.
This is good, yes.
We need that Will Smith summertime like song on. That's what we need.
Oh, yeah. You know? Yeah. You know what? I'm going to leave you in charge of the music today. How's that? Oh,
okay, then I got to run upstairs to the office.
All right. Hello, everyone. Welcome. We're going to get started in just a couple of minutes. And I see that Corchcorn KC Brad has joined us. And Jessica, Mitch, Monica, Jessica, again, Cosmos, Cherie, Carmen, Shivani, Clara, and Akib, thank you so much for joining us here this morning. We are about to get started in just a couple of minutes. You are in the Take Control of Your Life Club, and we're going to be talking about negotiating our way out of self-sabotage. Essentially, we're going to be talking and inviting you up to talk about some of the things that you may be struggling with in the area of self-sabotage. We have a number of great moderators who join us, and we'll pour into you and see if we can help you to get through those difficult situations that you're encountering. So on that note, I'm just going to give it another 2 minutes and we'll get started. So Michelle, what's happening in your life?
Well, I've been rolling. I have a morning room. It's called the Achievers Breakfast Club. I'm there like 5 days a week. That's how Coach Corin, I know him. And I've been loving that. And this weekend, I was supposed to be in the Hamptons, but my partner is sick. And so we can't go because there are going to be other people there and he might have COVID. We don't know yet. So anyhow, I'm here at home and I'm summer cleaning. So having a great day. And I'm excited to get into this topic because I just spent like 2 hours yesterday on the phone with someone on this very thing. You want me to throw on some summertime with DJ Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince?
Yes, let's do it. Yeah, let's do it while we get started.
Just close my mic in case I get an ad.
In the meantime,
kicking it off. Let's invite some peeps in.
slightly transform. Just a bit of a break from the norm. Just a little something to break the monotony of all that hardcore dance that has gotten to be a little bit out of control. It's cool to dance, but what about a groove that soothes and moves romance? Give me if it ain't broke, then don't try to fix it. Entangle the troubles of the past. Adjust the face to let the alpine blast.
All right, cool. Let's bring it down here. Okay, that was excellent. Thank you very much for sharing that, Michelle.
My pleasure.
I just wanted to say, I think we've got some echo from you, Michelle. There we go. Yep. Okay, we're going to get started now. We only have a couple of moderators, but that's all right. The purpose of this room is really to support one another. And what I would like to say from the very beginning is that what we share here is not intended to replace any type of therapy. What we do is we share from our experiences. Yes, we do have a couple of doctors who join us regularly, and hopefully they will be dropping in. They're sharing from their experience, but also they're sharing from their heart. So if you are in need of some assistance and you need therapy, please reach out to someone who is an expert in that field. Beware of who you speak to, because sometimes people don't have your best interests in mind. In this room, please consider it a safe place. We do talk about a lot of different topics. If you jump on stage and there's something that might trigger an individual, say, for example, we have some people who drop in and talk about sexual abuse, things that they have experienced in their past. If you think that your experience might trigger someone in the room, please just let them know that there's going to be a trigger warning. Tell them what it is. Give them an opportunity, if they don't want to hear what's being shared, to jump off and come back in within a couple of minutes. Now, as far as each and every one of you, we invite you to come up to stage and share your experiences or your challenges. We'll do our very best to help support you. We do have a back channel here, a dialogue going on. Yes, that little at the bottom, that little left-hand corner looks like just a talking thing. Just go on out there, and if there's something that you want to share there that you don't want to share on stage, please do that. We're going to monitor that, and if there's a topic that we can reach, we'll do it. This room will run for about 2 hours. We want to respect everybody's time, and we just want to get as many people up as possible. But if you are intending on coming up, do so sooner than later, because the hand raising will be turned off again to respect everybody's time. And I know that it is a Saturday here in Canada. It is the afternoon PM, and we are just ready to help. And so raise your hand, come on up. If you have something that you want to share, you're welcome to do it here. What I do normally, and what I would like to do now, is to pass the microphone over to my moderators so that they may introduce themselves to you, talk a little bit about what they do, maybe how you can reach out to them, and it'll give you some idea as to why they're here, because they're such great people. And then after that's done, I'll start with my opening session, and then we'll get right into some questions or some topics. So I am going to turn it over to Michelle. And hello, Dr. Allison. So nice to see you here this morning.
Thanks, Paul. Well, the number one reason I'm here is because over a year ago, I happened to follow Paul in here. I had heard him in another club. And when I came in, it was he and King. And they had this really incredible space where, you know, we were really talking about this concept of self-sabotage in all of its variations, of which there are a zillion. It's like, you know, turn over another rock and there it is again. And so, you know, for me, that was really exciting because my work the last 26 years has been specifically around supporting people to get clarity on what they want out of life and to really find the blind spots, both in their languaging, how they talk to themselves and to others, and in how they're able to shift the context of who they're being, to shift out of like a funky mood into a loving mood, from a frustrated mood to a mood of gratitude. And, you know, really talk with people on a very, very deep level about their own self-experience and their process of self-discovery. And so I lead transformational trainings once a month. And on the 20th, I'm actually training, I'm having a train the trainer class for people who are interested in becoming transformational coaches and trainers. And so, you know, I love that because I'm just passionate about people. I think every person is so interesting and no two people are alike, but we all share common conceptions and beliefs and attitudes and assumptions. And so, you know, I just really can't get enough of being in a space like this and being able to hold the space to create trust and to offer what I can to support someone where I can, with their permission, of course. And so that's a little bit about me. And I'm here again just to have a fabulous day with all of you. And I pass the mic on to King.
Thanks so much, Michelle. And great to see you again. And welcome to everyone. And my name is King. And obviously, I'm not a mental health professional to any degree. However, you know, because, you know, I'm just a communications and a marketing guy who talks about travel. But I obviously, you know, have lived some interesting times in my life. And so hopefully each week some of my experiences can help anyone that's going through any challenges. And but mostly I just learned so much from all the amazing people that that come by this room and share. And obviously the last year and a half has just been just amazing in terms of just showing me, you know, a lot of the different ways that I self-sabotage without even knowing and sort of figuring out how to, you know, get around some of those things that I'm doing unconsciously as well. And, you know, just learning along with everyone else in the room that does come and bravely share their stories on stage. And so I'm just happy to be here to support and happy to do whatever I can to help everyone, you know, get to where they like to be and just have a happier life in general. So with that, I'm going to pass the microphone over to Dr. Allison. So Dr. Allison, if you are ready, the stage is yours.
Thank you, King. Good morning, Paul, Michelle, Isaiah, everyone in the room. My name is Dr. Allison Okloofy. I'm a licensed clinical psychologist. I'm also an educational psychologist. And my raison d'etre is to help people live happier and healthier lives. And it's not just mental health professionals who can do this. You know, Paul, Michelle, and King have all shown themselves over the past year, at least, you know, that I've been popping in and out of the room, to be amazing individuals with so much information and so much encouragement and so much love. And so we all are capable of helping each other find that place in our hearts of kindness, of compassion for ourselves, and of love and kindness and civility for others. And I'm doing this right now. My focus is on my YouTube channel because as a former educator, it was so important to help people just to learn to be and to learn to love and accept themselves. So that's kind of where my love and dedication is now. But you can contact me here in Clubhouse. There's my Twitter. I'm not very active there. My website, however you need to. But I would actually just love to see you every Saturday in this room and hear your stories and have you come back and share your growth and development trajectories with us. So thank you so much for letting me introduce myself. Paul, back to you.
Well, thank you all very, very much. And Michelle, please feel free to post the link to your course above us and people can then refer to it. So I want to thank everybody who has joined us. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. My name is Paul Nadeau, and a little bit about myself. I am a former hostage negotiator and international peacekeeper. I also worked several years in the Special Victims Unit dealing with people who had been abused sexually and physically, child abuse and such. I learned a lot about self-sabotage. I also learned a lot about how
we choose to respond to the things that happen to us and how we can take control of thoughts, even though terrible things happen to us, we can turn it around. We don't have to let those things define us. We can define them. In fact, many people who have been abused and many people who have suffered a great deal, many people who have failed, have gone on to live amazing lives and to share their experiences with others to uplift them. And I think that that is so important for each and every one of us to remember. Life is not only a gift, folks, it's an assignment. What you choose to do with that is entirely up to you. Nobody can control you. You get to control yourself. Yes, we're going to get hurt by people. It's going to happen. However, how we internalize that, what meaning we attach to that, is entirely within our control. Nobody is greater than you. Nobody deserves more love than you. Nobody deserves anything more than you. The moment that you begin to realize that you are an equal, that we are all created equal, and that we deserve to be here just as much as everyone else, and we deserve this happiness, is the moment that we take control of our lives and start to change things. Now, when you think of the word sabotage, that's in the title, negotiate your way out of self-sabotage. So what is sabotage? Well, sabotage, the definition of that includes to deliberately destroy, damage, or obstruct something. We hear about this in the news. So-and-so sabotaged this refinery or this gas place, whatever. We hear these acts of sabotage going on all the time. There is a deliberate act to prevent something, destroy something, obstruct something. That's an act of sabotage. What does it mean then to self-sabotage? Well, self-sabotage refers to behaviors or thought patterns that hold us back and prevent us from doing what it is that we want to do, to live the lives that we deserve to live. Why do I use the word sabotage? Because once we are aware of what we are doing, and we continue to give in to those thoughts that don't empower us, to those thoughts that make us feel inferior or prevent us from moving forward out of fear or whatever it is, then we are committing a deliberate act of self-sabotage. The idea is deliberate. How do we then control that and turn things around so that we don't have to give in to those voices in our head? I'm going to give you some examples of what self-sabotage include. When I do this, I ask each and every one of you, take a moment, think of what I am saying, and see if you may be applying this to your life right now, if this might describe things that you're doing, and then what you can do to change that narrative. Nothing will change if nothing changes. You must then police your thoughts and make things happen. Only you hold the power to rescuing yourself. Other people can support you. Other people can guide you. Other people can give you a place to speak. But when it comes to rescuing yourself, that's your responsibility. Nobody's going to do it for you. So here we go with a list of things. As I said, please see if it applies to your life and see what you can do to change it and speak to us, drop in. We'll talk about it as well. Here's one: blaming others when things go wrong. Now, this can happen in jobs, relationships, whatever. If something is not going perfectly well, or there's a breakup, or you lose your job, some people will respond immediately. I'm going to retract that. They don't respond. They react. Some people will react by pointing the finger at somebody and saying, you know what, that relationship didn't work out because he or she did this or did that. Not my fault. Not my fault at all. It's the boss's fault. He had it out for me from the day I started. So when you blame others when things don't go right, when they go wrong, you're not taking accountability for yourself. You're not taking a moment to examine what happened with your heart to see what it is that you may have done that contributed to that breakup, to that job loss, to that disassociation with someone. It's your responsibility to take a look at what happened,
take a few moments and do what's called self-examination. Go deep into your thoughts and look it over. Write a few things down. What could I have done differently? What should I have done differently? What will I do differently? Because nothing changes if nothing changes. If you keep pointing the finger at other people when things go wrong, they're going to continue to go wrong. You can't change the behavior unless you change the behavior. So that's one. Choosing to walk away when things don't go right is another version of that. Things aren't going well. I'm not accomplishing what it is that I wanted to accomplish. So guess what? I'm just giving up. I just may as well give up. Is there a t-shirt that says, I gave up? A lot of people are giving up. A lot of people are turning to different things. They're turning to alcohol. They're turning to drugs. They're giving up. Hey, things didn't go right. I'm walking away from this world. It's out to get me. I'm not a fit in this thing. So I'm going to turn around and walk away and find something else to spend my time at. And that could be in the loneliness of my room with a few drinks, a few shots of whatever, some drugs, and some other behaviors that don't work towards making me a better person or dealing with the challenges of life. Nobody is going to live that perfect world. It's all going to be difficult at times. Not everything, but many things are going to be happening. Rocky's inspirational speech to his son, I say this often, and for those of you who haven't heard it, here it is. The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a very mean and nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it will beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. You, me, or nobody is going to hit as hard as life. But it ain't about how hard you're hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward. How much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. Now, if you know what you're worth, go out and get what you're worth. But you got to be willing to take the hits and not pointing the fingers saying you ain't where you want to be because of him or her or anybody. Cowards do that. And that ain't you. You're better than that. Let's remember that, because that is such a powerful speech and it reminds us that yes, it's going to get tough. And yes, we're going to get knocked down, but we can get back up and we can face those challenges and not blame others when things don't go right. We have to take the responsibility on our shoulders and make the changes that we choose to make. Another example of self-sabotage is procrastination. I'll get to it whenever. I'll be happy when. Whatever it is that you attach to that is like, this is overwhelming. It's such a big job. I take a look at this. You mentioned Michelle Will Smith this morning, and I was listening to his audiobook. And at the very beginning of his audiobook, he talks about how his father directed and demanded that he and his brother build this brick wall. The brick wall was going to be huge. And the boys were just young teens, and they were looking at this saying, it's overwhelming. We'll never get this done. And their father overheard them speaking. And of course, their father wasn't the nicest man. He came over and he just gave them heck. And he said, you don't look at the entire wall. You make one brick and you lay one brick perfectly. Then you go on to the next. And then you go on to the next. The idea, what he was saying, is to focus only one step at a time. In that narrative, he explains that they did reach a point where that wall was completely done and done well, and their father was happy. That's the idea of taking a look at something that may look overwhelming and saying, I can take this in chunks. I can do this for 2 minutes a day. I can do this for 20 minutes a day. I don't have to get it all done right now, but I can get some of it done. And the important thing is that I keep moving forward. That's the idea. Another form of self-sabotage is picking fights with friends or partners for what appears to be no particular reason. Sometimes that reason, if somebody's picking a fight with you and you're thinking, where's this coming from? It may be that they're not being seen or they're not being heard. That's often the iceberg behind the tip. It's that big area underneath the water that people are feeling unseen, unheard, unappreciated. It's time to open the channels of communication as opposed to fighting. Just asking where this is coming from. Just taking or having that difficult conversation, or even asking something, is everything all right? Can we talk about this? It's important that we do that. Another area is dating people where you know aren't right for you. Going back to a toxic relationship. A lot of people do that. Why? A lot of people don't feel that they have the value in themselves to ask for something more. So they keep sending out these vibrations that attract other people on the same level. And that can be very toxic and very hurtful. So another one, it's a big one. It's troubling. It's trouble stating our needs and desires. So many people will remain silent and they won't share what's going on inside them, their needs or desires with family, friends, at work, in romantic relationships, in everyday interactions. That's a big one. A lot of people blame others when things don't go right. They blame and shame themselves. Imagine blaming and shaming yourself for something that you did 6 months ago. Are you still that person? I hope not. I hope you're standing on the shoulders of that person you once were so that you don't have to go back and blame and shame yourself. You can say, guess what? Yeah, I did that 6 months ago. I sincerely apologize from the bottom of my heart. I forgave myself and I am now a better person because I am standing on the shoulders of the person I once was. And this comes down to a little bit of comparison. A lot of us will fall into the comparison trap. We'll take a look at other people's lives and we'll say, they're living such a great life. Why am I not living this? It always happens to them. Nothing great happens to me. And we start looking at that. Comparing ourselves to others allows them to drive our behaviors and our emotions. We're essentially giving them power and control over ourselves. We're feeling bad because they're living a good life and we're looking at ourselves saying, I'm not. Well, that responsibility to live that good life is yours. It's not theirs. So if you're going to blame anyone, take a look at yourself, examine yourself, and compare yourself to the person you were yesterday. I'll say it again. You are not the person that you were yesterday, hopefully, because you're standing on the shoulders of the person that you were. And you've made those improvements in your life. You've looked for those happy moments. You've looked for changing that behavior that didn't get you where you wanted to be. It didn't get you that person that you wanted to go out with, or that job, or that success, whatever it is. We cannot go back and blame and shame ourselves for things that have happened in the past if we are standing on the shoulders of the people that we are now today, because we're not that same person. Life becomes about being a better version of yourself. So the recipe for happiness comes from within. It's not from anything else anybody gives you. It's not from that. It's from how you want to bring it out. Happiness comes from within. Blaming and shaming other people is the same thing. It's putting ourselves down with those voices. I can't do anything right. This life is conspiring against me. All these things happen to me. Poor me. I'm going to go to the poor me hotel and I'm going to go to the why me lounge because all this happens for me. Life is against me. That is paranoia, folks. When you believe that the world is conspiring against you, that's a form of paranoia. Why not switch the switch and go into pronoia, the opposite of paranoia, and start believing that the world is conspiring for you. When you start to do that, you draw a particular energy into your life. When you truly believe that life is conspiring for you, it will. It answers the call. I don't know how it's done. I can tell you from my perspective, it works. Whenever I have, which I have that all the time, that life is conspiring for me, things, great things, knock at my door, pound through the door, and I see them. So that's the important thing about looking at life as though it was conspiring for you. Now, be ready to receive good things. Have that mindset that I'm ready. I'm ready. And pray to whatever you pray to or speak to the universe, whatever works for you, and just say, I'm ready. Bring it on. I'm ready for good things. I'm ready to leave my past behind. I'm ready to forgive myself. I'm ready to repair broken relationships. I'm ready. I am amazing. Use the I am. I am prosperous. I am powerful. I am.
I am is so great, and we don't use it enough. We use I hope or I will. No, I am works even better. Argue yourself imposed limitation. Dispute them. They're lying to you when they tell you that you're not great, when they tell you that you can't accomplish something, when those voices tell you all the negative things, that you're not worthy, that you're not this or you're not that, they are lying to you. It's your job to turn around and say, stop it. Stop it. Give it a name. Give it a name if that helps. When these voices jump into your head and start talking, you can say, hey, Jack, wait a minute. You're not welcome here. This is my mind. I am in control. I am the landlord of my thoughts. You don't belong here. Get the heck out. Start to change that narrative. Just become that person that you want to become. Get those thoughts, those positive thoughts, and replace the negative ones with the positive ones, and then use your body, your physiology. Start moving around. Start getting energetic. Go for a walk. Listen to some great music. You are in control of your own life. And that is my spiel for today. Thank you very much for listening. I see that we lost Isaiah. Probably didn't want to wait, but I hope he comes back. So I'm going to open it up to the panel here. I don't see any hands up, so we'll start with a conversation. What is it that we want to talk about today? Because there's so much that we can go through. Anybody?
I'll tell you something that happened last night, which was really interesting. I had someone call me, and they're in a relationship. And so, you know, sometimes we discover that we're self-sabotaging out of being in relationship. And, you know, this person was really suffering because they loved the person that they were in relationship with. They were living with them. They kept finding themselves running up against behaviors that were hurtful to this person, the person that I was talking to, behaviors from the other person in the relationship, things like them name calling or them demanding that the other person be silent, that they, you know, just didn't answer their phone or just, you know, ignored the person that I was speaking to and who's in relationship with this person doing those things. And why it was interesting to me is because this has been a conversation that we've been in for over a year, that this kind of behavior has been showing up. She's my friend, so I don't coach this person. And you know, it was so heartbreaking in its magnitude, because here's someone who I can bright, with incredible talents, and yet they were suffering. And it didn't matter, you know, where they were over this year, traveling, doing different things. Always the story is the same. And so much of what you shared, Paul, hit upon some of the behaviors that my friend is in. But the interesting thing is that we all have to learn it on our own time in our own way. And, you know, sometimes, you know, they say the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and waiting for a different result or hoping for a different result. And the thing about hope that a mentor and friend of mine said about hope is that hope is like rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic, that it isn't a very effective way of living our days and our weeks and our months and our years. And you know, what's so heartbreaking for me is to watch the same conditions and the, you know, even though they intellectually have an understanding that it's unhealthy, that they can't give themselves permission to let go of that relationship. And I think it's that this person does not want to let go of what they have for what they could have, because there's a gap there between the two, and there's an unfamiliarity, and this person would rather stay with what's known, even if it's painful, than choose, you know, what's unknown, even if it were to bring freedom and joy and health and happiness. So I don't know if anybody else wants to add onto the table about this topic, but it's something that I see often, in particular with my female friends, And so I wanted to bring it up to the speakers to see what they want to add to that.
I love that. I would have something to add to that, but I'm going to defer to any one of my moderators who want to add something before I do. Any one of you? Maybe not. Okay, I'll start with this. Michelle, you're so right that so many people find themselves in relationships that are not working for them. And I believe that there may be an element of learned helplessness sometimes in this, is that we become so familiar with perhaps abuse, or it may not even be abuse. It just might be a conditioning that happens in which we are constantly fighting or fearing or whatever it is. But we become so familiar with it, yes, to make the move into the unfamiliar, as you so accurately pointed out, is a scary thing. It's a scary thing to say, okay, but we have to look at our value. Am I deserving of this? Am I doing everything that I possibly can in this relationship to make it work? And if I am, the other person is not. And so there's an imbalance here. I am not feeling the love and fulfillment that I deserve to feel in this relationship, and it's time for me to move forward. And as you said, it is a difficult thing, and people work at their own pace to do this, but you're worthy of doing that. That's the thing. Fear of the unknown could keep us from moving forward. Fear of being alone can keep us from moving forward. The uncertainty is something that a lot of people are afraid of. What if? And we can what if ourselves to death. What if I don't find anybody else? What if this? What if that? The first thing that we have to do is recognize that we have to be happy with ourselves. We have to look at ourselves and say, do I love myself? Am I worthy of this relationship or a better relationship? Must I make some differences or some different things? Must I work on something to be the person that will attract a high-value mate, because I am a high-value person? So it is the thoughts and the meaning that we attach to so much. And I'm sorry to hear that your friend is going through this, but you're accurate. You're so right. A lot of people are in unhappy relationships because they're afraid of what the future holds. Because they cannot see something, they're afraid of moving forward. Robaire, did you want to add something?
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Paul. Michelle, the quote that you made about insanity, the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again, expecting different results, that comes from Einstein. And I think that's a very valid quote. What I wanted to add here was that sometimes in, you know, I think probably everyone on who's tuned into this room today has had an experience in their lives where they've had a relationship, a love relationship that hasn't worked. Probably 90% of the people here today have experienced that. Sometimes when you've tried everything, and again, getting back to that quote about doing the same thing over and over again, expecting different results, sometimes the answer is to simply walk away. And if the relationship is meant to be, then the other person will come back. You know, there was also, I think, I forget who it was that said this, that about how if you love something, set them free. If it was meant to be, they will come back to you. And I have found that before, is that, you know, if you're running into a brick wall in a relationship, you've examined yourself, and to me, and you know, Paul knows, and the rest of the moderators know, that I start from the premise that Socrates started from, self-examination. If you've examined yourself honestly and critically, and you have concluded that I have truly done everything I can to love this person, to try and, you know, set my ego down, to try and be as you know, warm and loving as I can be without compromising my own integrity, because that's important. Sometimes we compromise our own integrity in order to please the other. That's a big mistake. But you know, leaving that aside, if you come to that point, sometimes walking away is the answer. And if it's meant to be, then the person will come back. If it's not meant to be, then you may just find one day that someone walks into your life and you realize for the first time why it didn't work out with that other person. And so with that, bro, I'll pass it back.
Well, I'm going to say that was profound, bro. And I love what you said. the "if you love something, set it free," I think comes from a 1960s movie or 70s movie called Love Story. I remember that quote. I was a kid back then, and that stuck in my head. You're right, though. There are times where we just have to disengage because we value ourselves, and it doesn't mean that that's permanent. And it also gives us an opportunity to take that moment to do what Einstein said is, you know, like if something's not working, we got to change things. And we just got to examine our lives to say, okay, where could I have improved in this relationship? What can I do differently? And once we get that, then we are ready. And yes, if it's meant to be, the person will come back into your life or there's an opportunity. Sometimes we do get second chances. Sometimes we don't. The important thing is that we bring our best selves to whatever relationship and that we have the courage to then move from the ones that aren't working for us because, bro, you're right. It comes down to value. And if something isn't right, we just have to try something new. Michelle, you wanted to add something?
Yeah. Oh, well, first of all, thank you, Robaire, for that, and Paul, too. And I was also thinking about, I've seen it happen, and it was the truth for me in my first marriage. So I'll bring myself into the mix in terms of just being able to understand something, to confront it and finally, you know, allow some resolution in. And that was that I had this thought that my partner would change, right? That, you know, I could find my happiness outside of myself if this was the equation, my happiness equaled if the other person changed, right? Rather than I do my own work on myself, inside of myself, and maybe create some healthy boundaries, maybe, you know, understand what my values and principles are so that they don't get trod on, maybe communicate in a better way, blah, blah, blah. But, you know, during that time frame, I can remember feeling really stuck because I did love my husband. We'd been together for a long time. We had children. And yet I kept thinking that my happiness resided outside of myself. So that was thing number one. Thing number two was that I really kept thinking, okay, if I keep working really, really hard at this, then, you know, potentially what I'm doing may rub off on this person. And that isn't totally 100% the way it works. So, you know, I think sometimes I've seen in my conversations with clients and friends that there is this thought that, you know, it's possible through our own power to create the ability for someone else to change, even if they're not really ready or willing to change. It's like a fantasy. And so that fantasy keeps us wired in too. So I wanted to add that to the table because I think it's just really important to look at how often we'll tell ourselves stories that A, keep us disempowered, like me saying, okay, my happiness relies upon his behavior changing, right? Rather than my happiness relies within me. So being willing to do that, right? And thing number two, to buy into that fantasy that could even potentially be an opportunity or a possibility, right? And how long do we choose to live with that? So also looking at, you know, what's our own level of discomfort? How comfortable are we being uncomfortable in suffering and pain? Has that become a new comfort zone for us? So I thought I'd add that to the table too. Mike, back to you.
Thank you. And Michelle, what a great conversation that you started. And I'm going to add one more thing, and it's been said, but it really is about open communication. As I was going through the examples of self-sabotage, they included trouble stating your needs and desires with your romantic partner, the person that you're in a relationship with. If something isn't working well, it's time to sit down and say, hey, you know, and then have that open communication. Actually, some people schedule a time every week in which they can get together and talk about those. Hey, did everything go well this week? Is there something that you want to talk about? It is really opening up. Because if a person isn't aware that they continue to behave in a way that doesn't have their partner really feeling good about it, and they're not aware of it, then they'll continue to repeat the pattern. Once you become aware of something, then you can choose to make the changes that need to be made. Robaire?
Yes, thank you. Yeah, a great conversation. And thank you, Michelle. You inspired me to share a bit of my story. But just before I do, I wanted to say something about Paul, what you just said, which I think is very, very true, is the importance of checking in. But I'm going to suggest that the time to check in is at the very beginning of the relationship. And I'm going to recommend a book by Dr. Gary Campbell, I think it's called. Anyhow, it's called The Five Languages of Love. And if you haven't read that book, it is a profound book. It's probably, at least in my pantheon, it's sort of up there with Men Are From Mars, Women Are From Venus. And the whole notion here is that we don't experience love the same way, which means that our partner needs to understand how they can show love to us. I'm not going to get into the five different languages, but they are, each of them is unique. Each of them is, and you can love another person. You can truly love another person, but you might be showing your love in a way that they're not receiving. So getting your languages of love either aligned or at least understanding and recognizing what your partner's language of love is can truly enhance a relationship, because you know, for example, that if you receive love by receiving gifts, if someone gives you a gift, and for you, that's a sign of love, but that's not what your partner needs. That's not what drives your partner. Your partner wants words of affirmation, for example. They want to know that they're special. They want to know that they look great tonight, that dinner was superb, you know, that they're the best mother in the world or the best spouse in the world. If that's what drives them and you think you're showing love by giving gifts, it's not going to work. So at the very beginning of the relationship, it seems to me, is when you sit down and you talk about these languages of love. Again, the book is called The Five Languages of Love. In my case, just very, very briefly, I was dating after my marriage broke down, and I dated a number of different ladies over time. I entered into a relationship with a woman, and we got along well, you know, but you know, it wasn't complete, and we broke up. I started dating a different woman. That first woman came back and asked if we could try again, and I did. So she came back, but realized that it still wasn't complete. That then prompted me to go back to that other woman that had been in the interim and say, look, you know what? I felt complete with you. Shall we try it again? And we have. It's now been more than 5 years, and I haven't been happier. We are on the same page with respect to just about everything. And so the idea there, I guess that the reason for that is that sometimes leaving the relationship is the right answer, even if it's hard, and if it's meant to be, the person will come back. So with that, bro, I'll pass it back to you.
Thank you, bro. And there's a reminder to everyone that there are second chances sometimes, and sometimes it can be the very, very best thing. That little break where you realize and you start to make those differences, it can just be the right person and they'll come back. So Michelle, thank you so much for bringing this wonderful topic into discussion. And I hope that a lot of people, I know I have received from this talk, and I'm going to say yes. So we're going to move on. I see that Isaiah has joined us again. Isaiah, welcome to the stage. How are you today? Thanks for waiting.
Hi, everybody. Yeah, thank you for having me again. Yeah, I'm doing fine today. I hope everyone is doing good as well on a Saturday. And I just have a bit of an update from the last program last Saturday. So I was able to continuously do some journaling. I've been doing journaling for 3 years now, and just recently, even before the recommendation last Saturday, I was already including some sections in my journal for gratitude, and that is something that I've been doing for the past 2 months now, and surprisingly, that has helped me to reduce my attitude towards envying my friends and other people, and just focus on my self. And whenever I see stories or photos in IG or in Instagram and other social media, I feel less envious, and I was able to kind of control my thoughts about that. So the journaling has helped a lot, and gaining some perspective as well, and setting boundaries with people, not making myself too available for them, and just focus on myself and look at the things that are working in my life rather than complain. However, I ran into an issue because a friend that I met here sort of cut me off. So he said that he feels that when I message him, it's like he's being spammed. He felt my way of communicating is spammy, and I don't want to overthink it too much. To overthink in the sense that I would tell myself that I don't communicate that well, whether in real life or online or virtually. So I just wanted to ask, in terms of like, how can I not come across as spammy to my friends and individuals, other individuals, especially when communicating on them online? Because I'm aware that there are people that I message, I want to have a conversation with them, but then sometimes they won't feel that they need that conversation, or they want to chit chat, or if I'm explaining or sharing a problem to them that, or just an experience, that they're gonna be disinterested or really mentally or socially emotionally unavailable to receive and hear them. So that's my question for today. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Isaiah. Before we get into examining what changes or what you could do to improve in that particular area of your life, I want to applaud you in what you just shared with us before you asked the question. You've been doing your journaling, which is amazing. You've been doing that, as you said, for 3 years, I believe you said. And now you find that you're less envious of the people that you see on social media. You're in control of your thoughts more than you were before. You're setting positive boundaries. This is great. You are focusing on the things that are working and not so much the things that are not working. And I applaud you. We have a saying in this room, and I think each and every one of us should unmute and say, come on with it. What do you think, guys? Come on with it. Is this a come on with it moment?
Come on with it.
Oh, that's great. Isaiah, congratulations on those things. Now, when it comes to communicating, you know, the difficult thing about communicating and writing through texts or whatever is that so much can be left to the imagination. There are certain things that we don't get across 100% right. Now, I have a few thoughts on this, but I have been manipulating the conversation quite a bit. Do any one of my moderators want to speak on this? How can messages not come across as being so spammy with other people? Or is it something that we have to examine ourselves and just, it's okay if I send this message out and it doesn't matter how they respond to it? Any thoughts on this? Go ahead, bro.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, you know what? I wrestle with that too. I'm a bit of a wordsmith, you know, as a lawyer by day and sort of a critical thinker. For me, words matter. There is such a phenomenon. I just posted in my critical thinking series last week a post on the linguistic swindle, where words can be used to create a false reality. So we have to be careful how we use words. And, you know, this was one of the things that Plato had, it was more Socrates than Plato, that you know, he was opposed to the written word, because this goes back to, you know, 2,500 years ago, 2,400 to be exact, where, you know, he basically thought that when you wrote something down, the problem with writing something down is that it didn't discriminate, it didn't distinguish between readers. You know, someone who was very young could read it, someone who was old could read it, someone with education could read it, someone without education could read it, someone with certain life experiences could read it, others had not had that life experience. And yet, you could ask a ton of questions to this written statement over and over again, and you'd get the same answer all the time. And this is why Socrates and Plato were rather dubious of writing, although Plato went on to write the most beautiful dialogues in Western history, Western philosophical history. But there's some truth to that, is that when we write something down and we're not careful how we word the what we're saying, it can be so badly misinterpreted. Which is why I think adding emojis is not a bad way of trying to nuance what you're saying if emojis are available in the written word. As a lawyer, I always encourage my clients, when they're involved in any kind of a dispute or whatever, to make sure they get it in writing, you know, in an email or something, because that's important as a matter of evidence. But in ordinary social intercourse, you know, just be careful the words you use. Remember that once you've written something down, especially if you send it in a text or an email, it's there forever. And in theory, it's there for the entire world to see. Okay? And so with that, bro, I'll pass it back.
I'm going to pass it right over to Dr. Allison.
Hi. Isaiah, thank you so much for being vulnerable. There's several ideas and topics I wanted to address. And I want to start with, at the beginning of the pandemic, Esther Perel, who's a very famous psychotherapist, had shared a story about giving couples therapy on Zoom. And the couple were in this heated argument, and Esther was sharing some insight, and all of a sudden, both of the faces of the couple softened, and they looked at each other lovingly, and she was caught scrambling, like, what's going on here? What's going on? And what she did not see is that one of the couple put their hand on the other person's knee and gently squeezed it. And she missed all that nuance, as Robaire had shared. And so what I'm trying to relate here is that in any conversation, any communication, there's always underlying context. There's body language. There's nuances in eyes. Are they truly smiling and crinkling a true smile? And there's also the sharing of different levels of information and personal information. Not everybody needs to be privy to every part of your story or an issue. When people come to me and tell me they've shared their problem with, you know, 15 or all of their community, I ask, you know, what is the purpose in shopping for opinions? You know, are you looking for a consensus? Are you looking to get people to sign on and to go with your agenda? Or are you, what is the need for that? And so whenever there's communication, you think about, am I sharing to ask for advice, just to vent? Am I truly just asking for somebody to listen, to hear me? And so it's always important to do that. And if it's something that truly matters, there's nothing like in-person communication, because you get the full experience of the, we call it total body response, TBR. So you get the full experience, which is so important, especially when we're dealing with very sensitive issues. And if we're working, you know, in therapy, we can do phone calls, we can do telemedicine, which is fine. But, you know, it's that sitting near in proximity to somebody and sharing that environment that Deepak Chopra talks about, sharing the air with somebody and exchanging exhales, where these cells, you know, cell fragments are communicated between people. It's kind of this amazingly biochemical exchange. And the other thing I want to talk about is journaling in and of itself does not necessarily create brain circuitry changes. What does is the reflection upon the feelings underlying the gratitude. So if you're writing a gratitude journal to amp up the results, you can think about either expressing empathy or sympathy or any underlying emotion. So you're engaging the limbic system in with the prefrontal cortex to get the entire brain to work on changing that neurocircuitry. And when I talk about the feelings, it's like, let's say you're grateful for the sunshine, saying, I'm grateful that the sun is out today. Well, then imagine feeling the sun on your face. Imagine feeling the warmth suffusing through your body. Imagine the sun beating down on the earth and allowing the leaves to photosynthesize, to exchange carbon dioxide for oxygen, and allowing us to breathe in the oxygen and feeling that reciprocity of human flora and fauna relationships. So it's taking it to that next level. So I would recommend that as well. Thanks for letting me share.
Thank you so much, Dr. Allison. That was amazing. King, you had a question you wanted to ask?
Yeah, Isaiah, just to make sure that we are helping you in the best way and that we are targeting the right thing, have anyone mentioned what they found spammy about your messages? Was it just like the pure volume of it, or was it the tone? Do you know exactly what it was?
Yeah, I think in terms of the volume, sometimes I would message someone and if I don't get a response, sometimes I would message them again. And for this particular person, I think because I'm backtracking what made him feel that way. And I think it's because he might have felt that I'm raining on his parade when he shared that he had a date in a weekend. He approached somebody and then they went on a date, and I was might have sensed in my message that I was feeling envious of him, or I was pounding him on how he did it, and it's like I felt he doesn't want me to he doesn't want to share what he did to make that happen.
Okay. I mean, that in itself is quite, straightforward. Is oftentimes when people don't, and you're exactly right, like he just didn't want to communicate. And unfortunately, pushing him to communicate obviously makes him uncomfortable. And so it's tricky sometimes because, you know, obviously you're just looking for a response, but that obviously is a very easy indicator right there. Like if you do message someone and they don't respond to something, just leave it alone, because for whatever reason, you know, like we all know, like when we're being there are just times we just, for whatever reason, we don't want to, you know, we don't want to talk to someone, we don't want to communicate or whatever. It might not even be anything to do with them. It might just be whatever mood we're in, whatever is going on. So at least that's sort of an easy one. Just, you know, it's for something to work on a little bit is that no one you can't control when someone might respond to you. And sometimes they may never. So you just have to sometimes get used to being comfortable with not getting an answer to something, I guess is the really roundabout way that I'm going about here to say that. But I did want to make sure, just to make sure, because there are so many ways that people could perceive so many different things. And so I just wanted to make sure that that we made sure we addressed that. And with that, I'll hand it back over to you, Paul, to get over to whoever was next.
You got it. And what a great question, King, because that's very true. Unless we know the specifics, there's things that we can add, but it's so much nice to narrow it down. So great add. Jacqueline, I want to turn the microphone over to you.
Thanks, Paul. Happy to be here with everybody today. And Isaiah, thank you for that share. That's a very personal story to share. And you're not alone with that. You know, many of us at times have misunderstood communications with our friends. And, you know, especially when it comes to dating, that was a big topic. You know, I wanted to go back to something you had said earlier and what we had celebrated, and that was boundaries. And I think in this case, your friend is just made some clear boundaries what they're comfortable with. And you need to give them the respect for that. And listen, what works for him in his life, and if it's dating or family or other friendships or work, what we know is that every single person is so individual that what works for him may not even necessarily work for you. You're a very different human being, I'm sure, than he is. And what I would do is in turn just celebrate his wins with him for now. And when you have a chance to actually talk on the phone, then have that conversation and see if he'd give you some guidance. That's when we can change it around to hounding him for what he did to, wow, deep respect. You know, I'm watching what you're doing. I'd love to learn from you. Is there anything you could share with me? And if the answer is still no, you just have to respect that as his own boundaries, as you're creating your own as well. And I just wanted to go back to that because you'd been so clear on the boundaries you were making in your own life that in turn, we have to respect others as well. So I just wanted to add that in. And thank you, Isaiah, for being so honest with us. Back to you, Paul.
Thank you, Jacqueline. And that was a great share, too. Thank you, everyone, for this conversation. I just want to add just a couple of more things. What has been brought out, I think, is just absolutely amazing because, yes, we cannot control how other people will respond or whether they will respond. Good point, King, is that we cannot await a response because that response may never come in some situations. We're meaning-making machines. So often when that happens, when we're not getting the response or we send a message out and that person is not responding, we attach a meaning to it. Oh, they must not like me. They must be angry with me. There must be this. There must be that. The problem with attaching meaning to things is that oftentimes we could be wrong. And it's a matter of just letting it be, as has been said here too, is that we don't know what's going on in other people's lives. And we may think that somebody's got their life going and it's 100,000% great, whereas inside they're just breaking up, they're breaking down. Whatever it is, we don't know. So yes, as Robaire said, the importance of writing something, we don't know how it's going to be received. There's different ways that people will receive certain things. Attaching emojis to a message could help very, very much. Now what I'm doing, what I tend to do, because I'm aware that the text, the written word, can often be maybe misunderstood, but not appreciated as much, or I'm not emphasizing something as much. For example, I teach this in many of my classes. I say, you know, we can put stressors on different words. So if I were to say to you one statement, four words, I didn't do that. So that's the statement right there. If I stress this, when you listen to that statement, I didn't do this. If I say, I didn't do that, then I'm stressing the I, which implicates that I didn't do it, but maybe I know who did. I didn't do that. So that statement is pretty clear. They didn't do it. I didn't do that. Again, the stressor is on the word do. I didn't do that, but I might have been thinking about it. And I didn't do that. That, again, that stressor on the word that could mean I didn't do that, but I did something else. It's so important. We interpret these words and how people stress their words. And I did this as a criminal investigator. I had to listen to where the stresses were made, how it was said, what words were being used. With technology as it is today, and this may not apply to you, Isaiah, in your specific circumstances, but when I'm talking to the room, why not consider sending a voicemail? Those are so easy to do. You send a pleasant voicemail or whatever it is. It could be a serious voicemail, but you send this voice message. We can attach that to our regular messages now. We can attach something. Hey, it's Paul. I just wanted to check in with you. I hope that you're doing well. Whatever it is, short, sweet, to the point. We can also do video messages. We can send somebody something through WhatsApp or other social media ways of sending a message to somebody so they can see our face, hear our voice, and we can get that message out. The other thing that I would like to add to this, Isaiah, is that I know for myself, if there's a very important message that I'm writing, I'll often call on maybe my brother Robaire or King and say, hey, listen, I've got this message I want to send to so-and-so. Would you mind taking a look at it and seeing how that comes across to you? And if you have somebody that you can confide in, a confidant, and just say, I have this message I want to send out. And sometimes that person is you. Sometimes you have to look at that message and really truly imagine how the other people or the other person might respond to it. Am I saying what I want to say? Am I making it more about me and not about them? What is the purpose of this message? All these things come into play here. So that's been a great question, Isaiah. And I hope that everyone here has given you some things to think about so that you can apply them and make some differences. What do you think, Isaiah?
Yeah, thank you very much, everyone. Those are actually very helpful. And I think what Dr. Addison mentioned earlier about shopping for opinions, I think it's a habit that I've developed, especially during my self-improvement journey, because I wanted to see what other people had did and maybe if I could apply it. But then I have to learn that not everyone is open to saying or receiving, sharing things about their lives. And there are things that I don't really have to know, and which is why I decided to take 2 days off from messaging people. I stopped messaging everybody, not because I'm expecting them to message me back, but just to give time for myself and see how I can improve on my communication online. And unfortunately, that friend has blocked me on Instagram. I'm not able to contact him anymore, which is unfortunate. What I can only do for now is improve my communication for on the other people that I'm still communicating with. So thank you very much, everybody. I'm going to reflect on this further.
Dr. Allison would like to add something further to this wonderful conversation, Isaiah, so hold on for a second.
I just wanted to add, and not just for you, Isaiah, but for anybody who's on a path of self-improvement or growth and development, sometimes when we get a taste of how wonderful it is to grow and develop and become a better version of ourselves, we're on this fast track and we want answers, like for dating or for these things. And yeah, we get a little too ravenous for information and we might be a little too overwhelming to our friends. So what I find is a good thing to do is to pour compassion and love into yourself. How wonderful that you've taken yourself on as a project, this beautiful, wonderful project to hone and improve and to work on. But then realize that, as you beautifully said, Isaiah, that not everybody's on that same path and not everybody's going to be our biggest cheerleader. So finding somebody else, and again, finding the audience. And if there's not an audience, you know, if you go on YouTube or you go on the internet, you can just put your queries in and then look for legitimate sites to get some information and feedback while you're waiting for a trusted confidant or friend to get back to you. So you don't always have to rely on the same few people. And then being in Clubhouse week after week, we're always here for you, Isaiah. And there are other rooms that are, you know, as well, maybe not as supportive of King and Paul, but equally as supportive. So just want to pour some compassion into yourself, because it's obviously clear you're on this wonderful growth path. And just realize that not everybody is going to be growing as fast as you or going to be your biggest cheerleader. And that's okay, because we're all here for you and you're here for yourself. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, Dr. Allison, that was wonderful. You brought up something. Robaire, what is that website that you contribute a lot to as far as people can ask questions and then get it answered? Do you know the one I'm talking about?
Give me a little bit more context, bro.
You used to post a lot of your different thoughts there, or somebody might ask, hey, I'm struggling with this particular thing. Anybody have any ideas? I can't think of it, but I remember you posted some very colorful pictures on it along with your responses or your additions. Does that remind you of anything?
I'm afraid it doesn't. No, that's the only thing I can think of is I did that for a long period of time on my personal Facebook page, but that's all I can remember.
Okay. I know I'll come up with it. I'll take a look at Michelle.
Yeah, it could be. It's either like Quora. Could that be it? Is that what you're thinking
That's
of?
That's the one. That's exactly the one I was thinking of. Quora it is.
Quora it
and
is.
And the winner is.
I remember. Yeah, there it is.
Yeah, that's a great one.
To add it when I get it, when you get a chance, Paul.
Sorry, what was that?
I'd love to add one more thing off of Dr. Allison's share when you get a chance.
Well, that's over to you right now.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, thank you, Dr. Allison. That is just, you're such a kind. There's so much kindness in who you are. And so I thank you for sharing what you just shared with Isaiah, because it is true. We've got to be compassionate with ourselves and sort of pat ourselves on the back when we're up to stuff that takes us in a direction of health and wellness. And the other thing I was thinking of that made of such a big difference to me, Isaiah, too, was to understand that each of us sees life differently. And I know you get that because you're very bright, like on an intellectual level. But sometimes when people have the responses they have, sometimes it can be a bit painful, right? To not be able to reach someone that we thought were our friends or acquaintances. And I think it's so important to remember that each of us grows up sort of with our own movie in our head. And a lot of times people are actually responding to what's going on in their own head and not really, let's call it, quote unquote, the truth of what's happening. And so I just wanted to add that because I think the compassion piece for self and for the other person is so vital, because it's rare that we're all on exactly the same page. And the other thing I was going to say is one of the things that's helped a couple of people that I've worked with has been, we came up with like these little rules to text by, you know, like a bunch of us after we got divorced, you know, we're trying to figure out this, how much is appropriate to text someone? When do you stop? Are emojis important? Can you, you know, give someone a nickname? At what point, you know? Because sometimes you're having relationships with people that are very texty, and texts are so able, as Paul said, to be misrepresented. And I think, you know, one of the things that we all came up with was this idea that if we felt like it was a compulsion or like a deep need to like write to someone in that moment, we promised ourselves and each other, we called ourselves TEP, Team Emotional Protection, that we would put our cell phones in a drawer and go walk for a half hour and then come back. And I bring that up because I think sometimes the emotion is so alluring, or that feeling of need or that feeling of desire or that feeling of like, I have to do this in this moment. And so that was one of the ways in which we as a group of newly divorced women decided we would support ourselves to not act impulsively or, you know, without really thinking something through or giving time to settle. So I just wanted to add that in as a tip for everybody out there. And with that, I'm going to pass the mic right back to you, Paul.
Thank you, Michelle. That was really good. It reminds me of people who text once they're impaired, they're drunk, the drunken texts. Once a text is gone, once an email is gone, it's impossible to get back. It's always out there. And so, yes, taking a few moments or taking whatever time you need to send it when you have a clear mind and not based solely on emotion in the moment is very powerful. So thank you. Isaiah, did that answer your question? Did that help?
Yes, definitely. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. I appreciate it, as always.
Thank you very much, Isaiah. I'm just going to put you back down into the audience, but thank you so much. What a powerful question. And we celebrate the fact that your journey is taking on such a strong, new, wonderful vibration. And it really is about stepping into your greatness, and everybody has it. So thank you very much. King, are you able to reset the room before we go on to Tina Lurie?
Sure. Thanks so much, Paul. You're so welcome to everyone, and thank you for joining us in the Negotiate Your Way Out of Self-Sabotage Room that happens every Saturday at 1 p.m. Eastern Time. And of course, it's hosted by the Take Control of Your Life Club. So if you aren't already a member of the club, just tap the green house above our heads and become a member. That way you'll be notified whenever we do run this and other rooms that may happen sort of impromptu during the week. And of course, if you do know of anyone that might be able to contribute to the conversation or someone who might have a question to ask, make sure you ping them into the room to let them know about all the great shares that are going on here. And of course, if you could also share the room here either on Clubhouse or on the social medias to let everyone know that it is going on too, that definitely is greatly appreciated. And we, you know, thank you in advance for the support. And of course, if anyone does want to come up to the stage to speak, make sure that you raise up your hand and get up on stage sooner rather than later, because we will be turning off the hand raising very shortly, just because we do always try to keep the rooms at around 2 hours in length, just to be respectful of everyone's time. And there's about 45 minutes left, so we might just have just a little bit of room left on stage, but definitely raise up your hand sooner rather than later. But if you aren't able to speak, you can obviously put your questions or comments in the room chat as well, and those will remain open until the end of the room. And finally, I always let everyone know, you know, make sure, you know, because Clubhouse is driven so much by the people you follow, the rooms you go into, the clubs you belong to. So if there are people in this room who resonate with you, give them a follow. I mean, take a look around you, read their bios. Of course, you can always start with the amazing moderators up here on stage, because they're all fantastic people. So the people that you resonate with, give them a follow, because obviously that'll just make your experience here on Clubhouse that much better. And I also do encourage you to not just follow people here on Clubhouse, but also follow them off platform as well, on their Instagram or their Twitter, because that way it gives you a chance to get to know them better, and also gives you a chance to be able to reach out to them should you want to do that. And finally, of course, thank you so much to everyone for joining us here this Saturday. And with that, I'm going to pass the microphone back over to Paul.
Thank you, King. Great reset. All right. We see that Greg has joined us and Pete has joined us. I guess moderated Greg. He's such a powerhouse on this. And Pete, welcome back. Hope everything's going well. Before we get to you guys, I just want to say thank you to Tina Lurie for being so patient. And we're going to turn the microphone over to her. Tina Lurie, welcome. Are you there, Tina Lurie?
Hi, I am. I'm multitasking, and I was like literally just washing my hands. This has been such a great room, and I want to say hello to Michelle. I haven't seen Michelle in so long. I have not been on the app on Saturdays, and I'm so happy that I'm here and listening. And Paul, earlier when you started the room, I was listening in, and you were really just dropping gems about the comparison and having your own identity and being cognizant of like the choices and the things you do and the people you embrace in your life. I just want to just briefly give a quick little tip that has helped me. And I call it the 3D method, like a 3D movie. Whenever you're thinking of doing something impulsive, or you're thinking of, if you're having the angel devil discussion with yourself, okay, it's 3D: delay, distract, decide. And each D, try to start with 5 minutes. So you delay yourself from doing that thing, calling someone, responding to a text message, answering the call, whatever, delay it. And then distract yourself with something, play a great song, write 3 things you're grateful for. And then after you've done those 2 Ds, the delay, distract, go to the decision. Does this serve me? Is this something I need to fix? Is this something that's paramount now? And in that, I find evidence that I don't need to respond. There's something about the power of the pause. So if anybody's feeling a compulsion to respond to a DM or some sort of like, you know, you're like being propelled, try the 3D. It does make a big difference. And that's something that I came up with that I use really for all parts of my life, with my kids when they're driving me nuts, when I want to overeat because I'm feeling like I need a snack, or when I'm having some decisions with my work. So 3D: delay, distract, decide, and then gamify it. Go 5 minutes for the first, then 10, then 15, and then 20, then 30.
you'll find that you'll be productive and you'll find yourself in a position of power because you did make the pause. Thank you. I wanted to share about the relationships, because that's when I raised my hand when Michelle was like, oh, I was in this marriage, we had kids, I love. And that's so true. And also plus one about the five love language. And I love that book. I've read that. And the Men from Venus and Mars, or that book too. And then also Steve Harvey's book, Think Like a Man. There's a lot of those books that are out there. But what I will say is that for me, I learned not to point my finger, because my grandmother taught me when you're pointing your finger, there's three pointing back at you. So I learned to just go at the speed of grace and understanding that for now, this is where I am and this is where I'm going. And sometimes I'm just being still. That's okay. I'm not stalled. I'm just being still. And the practice of that has helped me in my relationships, and also letting my children see that I'm vulnerable and that I am weak. Because oftentimes as a single parent, I would try to always be stoic and have all the right answers and keep everything together. But then on the inside, just being an absolute private failure. It was a public success, but a private failure. So I hope that helps someone. This has been really enlightening. I'm gardening, and I'm just so grateful to be here. I forget how good a good curated Clubhouse room is on a Saturday, because I've kind of been out of it since February. Only kind of joining in Dr. Finance and Diamond's Room on Wednesday and having my Joy Collector Club as pop-up style. But Michelle, is always such a delight. I always enjoy hearing your gratitude. You're just a gem. I just wanted to say that to you, because I hadn't seen you in so many months, but you are really a magnificent. This is Tina Laurie, the Joy Collector.
Oh, Tina Laurie, you brought tears to my eyes. I just wanted to say that. And what a powerful share. Wrote in the chat, the 3Ds, I put fire by it. And I just wanted to add that I think, you know, this whole idea could be another room, a couple of hours with self-sabotage and the single woman. Because I think when you're a single mom, it has its own unique set of challenges. And without a partner to bounce things off of, in parenting, you know, you do, it's like, who is it? Was it Hillary Clinton that said it takes a village? I think that, you know, it does take a village. And that's why these Clubhouse rooms are so incredibly invigorating. And you do find people who resonate with you and have heart. And you're definitely one of them. So thank you so much for the very kind words and also for your wisdom. Paul, back to you.
Yes, thank you. And Tina Laurie, that was amazing. I love that. The 3D approach: delay, distract, decision. That's so powerful. We're going to use that from now on. Thank you so much for sharing that. And I appreciate you being here today. So thank you. All right. So we're going to move you back into the audience, but we're going to go over to, I see Greg is on the phone. We haven't heard from Jacqueline. Jacqueline, would you introduce yourself? And then we're going to go over to Pete.
Yeah, sure, Paul. I'm climbing the side of a mountain, literally, as I'm here with y'all today. But for those of you that don't know me, my name is Jacqueline Way. I'm the founder of a charitable organization called 365 Give. We teach, inspire, and empower people to give every day. And what I've come to realize as I did this practice with my 3-year-old son is giving is truly love in action. And if you're feeling stuck, if you're not feeling that love for yourself, I highly recommend starting a practice of giving. Because when you give with no expectation of anything in return, it will come right back to you. And it will literally feed your soul. It will increase your happiness. It will increase the love in your own life. And it will begin to be that process of filling your own cup. So thank you everyone for having me today. I'm always happy to be here on Saturday mornings with this amazing group of people. And I look forward to hearing from everyone else today. Thanks, Paul.
Oh, thank you, Jacqueline. Robaire, did you want to ask?
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to add something to Tina's very excellent share. At some point, Tina said about how she has learned that, you know, by showing, her authenticity, by showing her weakness to her kids. I don't find that a weakness at all. I think when we show, and I think she probably meant more vulnerability than weakness, but when we show our vulnerability, to me, that is really a sign of strength and not weakness. To be transparently vulnerable, I think, is probably takes the most courage of anything. So just wanted to add that little footnote.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for that. All right. One thing that I wanted to add to what Jacqueline said, too, is when we give to other people, you know, our lives are going to end at some point. We all know that. There are certain realities in this world, and one of those realities is that we have to pay taxes. The other one is that we're going to die. So everything a man does for himself, he takes with himself. We take everything with ourselves that we do for ourselves. But everything a man does for others, he leaves behind. And that's a powerful, I just heard that this week, and I had to write that down. What we do for others stays behind. So that kindness, whatever it is that you've given to other people, will live on. So what is it that you're going to leave with other people? Another thing that I want to add is that Jacqueline, out of breath, because she's climbing the side of a mountain. And isn't that what we're all doing? We're climbing the side of a mountain to get to where we want to be. And we're going to be out of breath from time to time, but that's okay. The important thing is that we're climbing the side of the mountain. We're not sitting at the bottom of it, looking at it and saying, it's too high. No, we got to do what Jacqueline's doing. We got to climb the side of the mountain to get to where we want to be. And it's not always going to be an easy journey, but it's a one worth taking. And once we get up there, we say, look where I am now. And I think that's powerful. I saw that image in my head, Jacqueline. Thank you for sharing that. Out of breath or not, we're so happy that you're here. And before I go over to Tay Z, Eleni, I skipped you. I'm sorry that I did that. Are you able to introduce yourself to us before we go over to Pete?
I sure am. Hopefully you can hear me. I keep going in and out. So I'm Eleni. I'm an artist, a painter. But also on the side, I do lots and lots of healing for people that have emotional or physical ailments, as well as I work with a charity that helps underprivileged children come out of being a victim into being survivors. So I'm just here to share and pour into many people, and I'm Eleni.
Thank you, Eleni. I see Greg has jumped off for a moment. So, Pete, welcome. Are you there?
Most definitely. Yeah, I'm definitely here. I can pinch myself and I know that I'm here and I'm alive and I'm well. Look, very briefly, first off, Paul, I just want to once again commend you for continuing to hold this space. I've seen a lot of people come and go on Clubhouse. I was the first person to write a book about Clubhouse featuring 35 different people that were using the platform. And of the 35, I think there's only 6 that are still using the platform. So I'm very grateful to you, the space that you share and you hold and the people that you bring into this world, into this room, giving people a voice and giving people like myself a chance to speak. Now, I don't know how many of you believe in miracles, but many of you know my wife was given 18 months to live 11 years ago with a very aggressive brain tumor. I fundamentally believe a few things. I believe there is an answer to everything. And I believe it's not what you know, it's who you know. And I learned that from my parents. So 11 years ago, we found a treatment. We went to America against the advice of many other people. And I saw what happened with my wife on this treatment. The tumor shrank and it disappeared. And then in November, it came back. And she was diagnosed with the most aggressive brain tumor, glioblastoma multiforme. 6 months to a year, if you're lucky. That was in November. We found a treatment in Germany and, you know, it's amazing. I've just posted a video about it and I'm really sharing this, you know, Michelle and Paul and Jacqueline and Eleni and many other people in the room have been a part of this journey. But what's happened in the last few days is the closest thing I've ever seen to a miracle, you know, in terms of what my wife is now able to do, which she couldn't do. And what's so fascinating about this is just what I wanted to share. That sometimes if you look in the box, you just find what was already there. If you want to find something else, you've got to look elsewhere. And a lot of people don't want to look elsewhere. They just want to look at what they know. And in the medical world, we understand that people have to be very careful about what they say. But I've always been a person that wants to go ahead
and go and see what's out there for all of us, the possibilities that exist for us. But what's truly fascinating is that her medical team here in the UK had already been out to Germany to see what the doctors are doing. Because, you know, good news, it does travel, but people are very slow in moving forwards. And with my wife being so much better and continuing to get better, this is far more than just about her. This is about other people who find themselves, as Eleni knows, having worked in that world, that when you're diagnosed with a condition like an aggressive brain tumor, it seems like there is no hope. But I believe there's always a way, and I believe that I'm being tested. If I really choose to believe that, then can I, like you just said, Paul, can you still climb the mountain? I'm loving climbing the mountain. I just want to thank all of you for your support, because I'm only here in this room right now because I just want to share with you what is happening, because you're all a part of the story. So I'm very grateful. It's still very early days, but it is the closest thing I have ever seen in my life to a miracle. So thank you, Paul. I'm sending you love. You know that, my friend, I've got your back. And as to so many other people in this room, you have no idea. And maybe one day we can get Hannah in. Well, she comes on Clubhouse occasionally, but I'd love you all to meet her at some point. So back to you, Paul. Much love.
Wow. Thank you, Pete. And thank you for that update. I do believe in miracles. And I think that everybody here can share that with you, is that we do believe that wonderful things, miracles can happen. And we're so happy to hear that. You touched on so many different points too. It's like nothing changes if nothing changes. If we just look at the box and we don't see anything outside the box, all we're going to see is what's in the box. We have to look elsewhere sometimes to find new solutions or new areas to explore. Glad you're climbing the mountain. Glad the mountaintop is looking bright. And we're sending you our love and our prayers, my friend. Thank you so very much for that. And yeah, we can't wait to hear the rest of this story, because it's going to be an amazing, wonderful, wonderful story. So thank you. Do any one of my moderators want to add something before we go to Tazi? Michelle?
Yeah, I just want to say I'm overjoyed, Peter, or Pete, that you managed to get to Germany. And they are so much more advanced there. So, whippee, I'm so excited for you and your family. And yeah, I'm just overjoyed to hear this great news.
Well, thank you, because you were one of those people that literally just went out of your way to say, let me help you. And that's what makes the Clubhouse experience so much better, right? It's just the fact that people are wanting to help and support in a way which I've never seen on social media before. So thank you, Eleni.
You know, Pete, it's Michelle. What I hear in your voice is absolute abundance. I just hear the love for Hannah, the gratitude for the opportunities that presented themselves to you. And I want to say part of that is just you. It's you. You source this extraordinary experience, you know, for people here on Clubhouse by who you are, by your calling. I mean, you have a calling. That's my own interpretation. And it comes from like this deep love. And I am just so, I'm so grateful and thankful that you received, and that you and Hannah, you know, went on this odyssey together, the way in which you have. And it's such an example of partnership, of true partnership, and of true giving. And so many people, you know, were so struck on this app by who you are to begin with, and then secondarily about what you create in terms of space for other people to be loved, heard, seen, listened to. And so my heart's just really full, because life gives back, and it really does. When we are in that space of contribution, which you are, it's amazing what can be created. And I'm very excited to hear that Germany seems to be your new location. First the USA, now Germany. And I do know that you know, just being in that shifted place of uncertainty is no easy task. But it sounds like all the love that you've created in your lives is so surrounding you. And so I just wanted to share that and just hope to, you know, keep on being able to support you guys however you need.
Well, look, once again, I don't want to hog the room here. I just want to thank you because not that this is a word, but if it was genuality, just the genuineness about you, Michelle, and Jacqueline, and so many of the people, and Paul, that I've actually never physically met, but we've met in these kind of kindred spirits. And so much of what the treatment is about, it's about viruses, and it's also about vibration, frequency, you know, that healing through frequency. And I think we all know that. I think we all deep down know that the power of love, the power of that frequent, these different frequencies which heal the body. And I've just posted, if you guys get a chance, just look at the last Instagram post and you'll see my wife and you'll see her talking about what she can do with her arm because she couldn't move her right side. She couldn't use her hand. And if you look at the video, you think, how is this happening? You know, and it's like, I just wanted to share. I really wanted to share. And once again, Paul, thank you for the space that you and King create. And you're very consistent with all of this. And it inspires me to continue to do the same. So I'm done speaking. Back to you.
Thank you so much, Pete. I think Jacqueline wants to add something, and I'm not sure if King does. But Jacqueline, go over to you.
Well, you know, how could I not? Pete has literally been my own savior at different times in his life. And for those of you that have not heard Pete's gratitude meditation, I encourage you to not only go and listen to it. It's how I found Pete even before Clubhouse. But the practice that he created every day for gratitude is going to lift you off your feet. It's truly a gift to the world. And it's really what I wanted to go back to, and Pete, you're such a beautiful example that you could have completely and totally self-sabotaged your entire family with this happening to your wife again. And you didn't let it, my friend. You are such a beautiful role model for us all that when things get really hard, surround yourself with love, ask for help when you really need it, and do something different. And, you know, I think for all of us that have those times that we are self-sabotaging ourselves, we can now see as the pure living example that Pete and his wife are giving us on what's actually possible. And you're just amazing. I love you and Hannah. You're just such remarkable people. And we're so deeply grateful for you, my friend. So I just want to tell you how much I love you and say thank you. That's you, girl.
Excellent. King, did you want to add something or were you just applauding?
I was just applauding, but I did want to say thank you to Pete, and I'm so glad to hear that your wife is doing better. And so that's it.
Thanks. And Robaire.
Yes. Hi, Pete. I don't think we've ever connected directly before, but I just wanted to add my admiration, my genuine admiration to you, for you, for your love, the demonstrated love for your wife, commitment to her. You know, I don't know if it was Michelle who said it or Jacqueline, but you are a role model of what a true man is. There's a sense in which, and I know it's not politically correct, but that's okay. Being a man is supposed to be someone that sort of protects the family. That's been sort of traditional for a long time. And when I see and hear your commitment to her, her healing, you just strike me as being quite a role model. So I just want to extend my admiration to you and just wish you and her the very, very best.
Thank you so much to Jacqueline and to Robaire. I appreciate you guys sending love right now.
All right. Thank you. You reminded me of something too. The vibrations that we give off just have an impact not only on the people that we are around, but on the universe. And so when we project these positive vibrations, positive things return to us. It's the boomerang effect. Whatever you release, you get back in return. And I so appreciate what you shared with us, Pete. You also, there's a difference between hope and faith. And I'm just going to add this before I go to Tay-Z. And it's a Jim Carrey quote, and I just love this. He said this: I don't believe in hope. Hope is a beggar. I believe in faith. Hope walks through fire. Faith leaps over fire. And that's a quote from Jim Carrey. So you are leaping over fire, my friend, and you are sending out those vibrations into the universe and into everyone that comes in contact and connection with you. And that's making such a big difference in the world. So thank you so much, Pete. We love you, man.
It takes one to know one, my friend. You know, that's the thing, right? That's what keeps us coming back, because we vibrate at a similar frequency. And this is far bigger than me. It's far bigger than my wife. This is what makes the world a better place, where we come together, we share what we find, we help each other, and we celebrate each other. So thank you so, so, so much.
You're most welcome, and we can't wait to hear the progress that's being made. Yes, and remember, everybody, and I'm speaking to everybody here, the vibrations that we set off in this universe and in our surroundings will really communicate something to the people and to the environment and to the universe around us. And a lot of people, again, and I've done some study in this, and I keep listening to these great videos on this, these YouTube videos on the vibrations that we set. And if somebody, for example, is always in a negative state of mind, hey, I won't meet this person because every woman is this way or every guy is that way, and they have that mindset, that's the vibration that they're going to be setting out. And so they're not going to reach the people that they want in their lives. They're going to reach the people that they have made up in their mind. Every person is going to let them down. So that's who they're going to attract into their lives. And it's very true. When we begin to believe in the very best and we start to send out those very best vibration, that's what we're going to attract. And it has to do with every aspect of our lives. So thank you, Pete. Tay-Z, I am so grateful that you are here, and thank you very much for your patience. Are you there, Tay-Z? Tay-Z may have stepped away. Tay-Z, are you there? We'll come back to Tay-Z. So Maya, did I get that right? Is it Maya?
Yes. How are you? Thank you so much for having me. Yeah, it's Maya, like Maya Angelou.
I love that.
So thank you. I think this is my first time here. I am grateful to be on the stage. I have been listening and everything just resonates with my soul. I just wanted to add something for me as far as self-sabotage, and I put something in a comment about it. So I believe firmly that everything we see in our reality is a reflection of how we see ourselves and how we see life. Ultimately, you know, are you happy with the person in the mirror? Or do you believe that life is for you and not against you? And I feel like everything that decisions that we make in life depends on that. So are you, you know, if you have to take a risk and go after following your life purpose, if you believe in yourself and you believe in life, you're more likely to take that risk versus somebody who didn't negative, like you just mentioned, and doesn't believe that life is on their side and doesn't believe like they are deserving of a great life, they are probably less likely to take that chance. They're less likely to give somebody a second chance. They're less likely to think that they're going to heal from a disease. So hope, yes, faith, all of those things are energy. And if we see life and ourselves in a positive way, we emit positive energy. And that helps us mentally, emotionally, and also physically, because we know emotions can have physical manifestations. You know, a lot of back pain, for example, you know, relates to the root chakra, which is, you know, safety issues. So I cover a lot of childhood trauma, and my whole purpose in life is to help people heal childhood trauma so they can release the pain. And, you know, I know that, you know, back pain related to chakra, root chakra safety, not feeling protected as a child, you know, that manifested for me in a lot of back pain. And I know sometimes it is physical, but sometimes it's also emotional and mental. So if, you know, you see that life is not really going your way, sometimes just ask yourself a question, you know, do I really believe that I'm good? Do I believe I'm lovable? And do I believe I deserve the life of my dreams? And then the second question, do I really, really believe life is for me? Because if you believe those things, you'll take the chances. You'll wake up and have hope the next day. You will not give up. You know, you will think you're going to find another relationship. You know, you will know that, you know, you will get out of debt. Yeah, you will heal. So a lot of things depend on those two things. So I, in my own emotional healing, I made sure that I spent a lot of time giving myself back love and opening my eyes to the love that already exists in the universe for me, in nature for me, making a list of all the things that are good for me, that are helping me in my life. And the more I make that list, the more I say, okay, then I must be loved. If this happened to me, I must be loved. The universe must love me. And then I make a list of my victories. You know, I overcame this. I did this. I accomplished that. So I have faith in myself too. So it's a combination of those two things that help me release the self-sabotage. And that's what I use, you know, to help people heal as well. So this is Maya Catherine. I am extraordinarily happy to be here. I'm an author, speaker, and life coach, and I yield my mic. Thank you for having me on the stage.
Thank you, Maya. That was a wonderful share. You touched on so many different things. I don't know if any one of my moderators want to add to this wonderful conversation. To anyone? All right. Thank you, Maya. I really appreciate you. I hope you come back next week as well. I'm going to touch on a couple of things that Maya talked about. Who is it that you look at when you look into the mirror? And what Maya was saying is so true. When we look at the person in the mirror, who is staring back at us? Is that a person that we would date? Is that a person that we would give a job to? Is that a person that we would invite into our circles? Is this someone that we would like to be and spend time with? And if it's not, it comes down to the Socrates, an unexamined life is a life not worth living. We have to examine ourselves from time to time, and we have to do this. I encourage it in my book. I encourage people doing this once every couple of weeks to begin with, especially to begin with, and to be brutally honest about who you see on the other side of that mirror. Who is that person? And when we examine some of the relationships that we have, if not all the important relationships that we have, what is it that I could be doing differently? Who is it that I want to become? What must I do to become this wonderful person or whatever? A lot of us say, and I want to do a good job. And I remember this being something that was told to me, hey, as long as you're doing it, make sure that you're doing a good job. And go on out there and be a good partner. Go on out there and be a good person. Why don't we replace that word good with outstanding, amazing, heroic, whatever? Good is not good enough. When we start saying, I want to be an amazing, I want to be an outstanding partner, and what must I do to become that outstanding person? I want to be above who I was yesterday when I look at myself in the mirror. So Maya, that was powerful. It's so true. The energy that we omit is the energy that other people receive. If we omit little to no energy or dark energy, that's what the recipient is going to get. If we are down on ourselves because we don't believe in ourselves, we're self-sabotaging, thinking that other people deserve so much more than we do, then we are lying to ourselves. We are allowing the lies that maybe other people have told us. Because as Maya alluded to, a lot of things that we struggle with now could come from our childhood upbringing, from the things that were said to us, from the things that were done to us, from what society has said, or those bullies that bullied us and told us that we weren't worthy, that we were ugly, that we were never going to amount to anything. Imagine the conversations that you've had in the past, and imagine now you are not that person. You don't have to listen to the lies of others. You get to create your destiny. You get to look at yourself in the mirror, and you get to say, I can, I am, I will, but more importantly, I am, and make it happen. So I see that Tazi has rejoined us. Tazi, are you there?
Let's see if I can get in. Can you hear me?
Very faintly, but we can hear you.
All right. I'm just coming over the grapevine. I'm on a road trip.
Woo!
Can you still hear me? I know, because I keep coming out in and out of reception. But I just want to share with you. I just want to express my extreme gratitude to all of you. As you know, my sister died, and I'm just coming out of 10 days of intense grief. But, you know, it seems like that's in hand and will come in and out like waves, like grief does. But I'm such a lucky girl to have had her in my life. And I just so very thankful every day for that. And I don't know if you can still hear me. Enough,
we can.
Anyway, okay, great. So I'm heading up north, actually to a memorial service for a friend of mine up in Seattle area, but I'm going to stop in at the Bay Area for a visit with friends. I just feel like I'm starting this new chapter in my life, and what I want to share is two things. After she died, the guilt started creeping in. Did I do enough? Was I there enough? Did I make the right decisions? And I sat down with some very close dear friends, and we walked through that one time, two times, three times, and I've got it now. I mean, I did well by her, and she helped me in so many ways. And then the second thing is the shame piece that, Mr. Paul, you and I worked through at the very beginning when I started coming on this room, and I worked through it with you. And I got to tell you, with those two pieces in hand, I'm able to love myself. And once you love yourself, you know, you just, everything else fades away. It doesn't mean you're not loving of others. It just means that you're not reacting to them the way I was. And it's just, I want to just thank you again and again. And that's it. Road trip.
Woo-hoo! Jacqueline, Jacqueline, did you want to add something? I think this is great.
Oh, you know, Tazy, we've been on this journey with you and your sister. And first of all, my heartfelt condolences, my friend. I know how dedicated you were to your sister, how much you deeply loved her. Oh, you were just a remarkable, remarkable inspiration to us all. For the level of care, and not only the care, but the time that you took, even just in this space, working through the challenges and the difficulties some days. And I want to, first of all, just give you the biggest hug, because I am in such deep respect for you and all you did for your sister. And today I'm going to celebrate her, because the part I got to see in the relationship with you and your sister is how much she helped you grow. And what a beautiful relationship that was. And that's truly something that we all could take a look at in the relationships in our lives, especially with our siblings. And I'm celebrating her that she's free from her body right now. I have a very deep belief, Tazy, that this is just a physical experience. And she's just transitioned into a new form. And I can't wait now to hear the stories of how she keeps coming into your life and just tapping you on your shoulder, and you're going to feel that love from her. You're going to feel the energy of her in your presence. I'm getting the goosebumps right now, which tells me she's right here with us. And I just wanted to send you so much love. I'm just so damn proud of you. And enjoy every minute of that road trip and have her right there beside you. Put the music you listen to together. You know, think of the amazing memories you had together, and she'll be right by your side the whole time. I love you, my friend.
Yeah, I'm going to mimic everything that Jacqueline said. Yes, that was, you know, when we look back at your journey with your sister, you were there for her and you shared so much of your heart with her. Those are memories that you'll have with you forever. My condolences to you too. And I know it's not easy when we lose someone who's so close to us. My brother and I, when my mother passed away, we, of course, everybody feels the loss in our lives, and we celebrated her life. And I remember at the funeral, we were shaking people's hands, smiling and thanking them for being there. And some people turned around to us and said, you know, this is unlike any funeral I've been to before. And we just said, we're celebrating my mother's life. Thank you so much for being here. You know, let's celebrate together. And when we look at somebody's life, it is so important that we celebrate it. And not to say that there weren't any tears at my mother's funeral, certainly there were, but there was also some joy and some sharing and storytelling. We just celebrated her beautiful life, that woman that brought us up, that angel that left and departed, has never departed. And so that person is with us all the time. And I see my mother's picture every day. In fact, I just looked at the picture frame as I was saying this, and my mother's picture is right in front of me. How's that for the divine stepping in? So Tazy, thank you so much. Enjoy your road trip, and we love you, girl. All right, I'm going to just move her into the audience because I think she may have lost reception. So we've come to the end of the day. What I like to do is go to our moderators for any final thoughts if anybody wants to contribute, and then we will close the room off. So Pete, anything that you would like to add before we close the room?
Just, sometimes it's, words don't really do things justice. If I was going to explain what you mean to me and what so many of you mean to me, that there are no words, but perhaps in between the words, you can feel that space of just love. And that's all. I'll keep sharing and I'll keep showing up. It's also just a massive shout out to some of the most amazing people in the world that are in this room. And there's a guy called Dr. Ray Sylvester, who I met on Clubhouse, who's become a mentor, a coach, a best friend. And I met him yesterday. He's from England, but he's a professor in the States. And he's here with his wife and his family. And I met him yesterday. And it was like meeting this kindred spirit, like we'd known each other all of our lives. And that's the power of what this app has given so many of us. So big shout out to you, Dr. Ray, and to Matt, and to Sharon, and to many other people in this room, Frank, Amir. So many of you, you know, you inspire me to just keep going no matter what. Kate, I see you as well in the audience. But yeah, thank you for the opportunity to speak, Paul. Back to you.
Thank you. We feel the same way about you, brother. Thank you so much for being here. Jacqueline, over to you.
I love that you did that shout out today because, I mean, the amount of people that come back week after week, ZZ and Sharon and Christy, I see you all. So many friends, Frank, Gary. Been here, I think, the whole room now, and I just wanted to say thank you because the space isn't about us being on the stage chatting with everyone. It's about all of us being here together because everybody's taking turns with our own tough times in our life. And life isn't about solving all those problems. It's not about conquering it all and walking away into the sunset and every day's perfect. It's really just about how do we find that underlining vibration of joy. How do we find the tools and strategies in our own lives to really help us cope with the outside world as it comes at us pretty strong every day? And how do, in each and every moment, we make a choice that's towards feeling better, feeling good, feeling love, and finding the true happiness in our life? So thank you everyone for coming. This is not our space. This is everyone's space. And we're so happy that you're here with us each and every week. So thank you so much. Paul, back to you.
Thank you. Right over to Eleni, if Eleni has reception. And she has no reception. So over to Robaire.
Thanks, Paul. I think, as I'm trying to reflect on the entire last 2 hours, I think... Jacqueline just kind of put her finger on, I guess, what my parting comments would be, and I'll just kind of unpack it a little bit, is that this is a journey. This is a journey. We're on a journey. The journey, every journey begins with the first step. And so everyone that comes, visits this room and listens and shares, makes himself vulnerable and transparent, and receive a lot of, you know, very able, sensitive, thoughtful, caring advice and counsel from many different moderators and other speakers. Remember that it's a journey. And so you're not going to overcome the self-sabotage overnight. It's going to be a journey, one step after another, after another. Keep coming back, getting the energy, getting the encouragement and support that this room can bring. Find some trusted others in your life that you can really count on and go one step at a time. And so with that, Paul, I toss it back to you.
Thank you, bro. Well said. And Dr. Allison.
It's so funny, Jacqueline and Robaire just shared things that I wanted to say about just appreciating and enjoying the journey and maybe just looking in the mirror and saying, I love myself, I accept myself, and I approve of myself. Looking into your eyes and just taking the time to see yourself as we had talked earlier. And just sending love to everybody. Have a beautiful weekend.
Thank you so much. And over to Michelle.
Oh my gosh. I thought this room was absolutely beautiful because of the people in it and the purity of heart I felt in here, that I experienced in here, and the way that every person that came up was giving, people who were in the chat were giving. And that is something that is extraordinary. And I guess what I would say is on this whole subject is that I've always felt that there are certain rules for living in space, certain rules for being in that place of joy or really seeing that we really don't lack anything. And the first thing is that who we are is love. And knowing that, what would love choose? Not fear. And knowing that, can we make everyone and everything right, including ourselves sometimes? Because I think we're so indoctrinated to judging. And then, you know, the other thing I think that's so important is just really to honor our connection and honor this experience of time that we have. And maybe not count our time by the clock, but by the experience. Just be in that space of timelessness. Because I think often I find in there the peace, the joy, the lack of suffering, and the discarding of the illusions that I'm not sufficient. And so I hope everybody will come back next week and the week after and participate, because I think it's such a beautiful room. And I learn so much from each person that comes and shares. And so, Paul, thank you most of all for sourcing this room, for taking what you've learned from your history, from your own self-discovery, and giving it away. And I'm just really grateful to be a part of your team.
Thank you. And I'm so grateful to have you as part of my team and every one of my moderators as well. You know what I see? What I see right now is who I see. I see each and every one of my moderators on stage. I see Tazi, Berna, Murray, Amar, Hitomi, Mustafa. I see Dr. Shira. I see Gary. I see my friend, Dr. Finance, whose show I'm going to be on in about a week. Actually, a week today. A week Friday. Omar, Frank, Christopher, Christy, Jackie, Kate, Tolu, Dr. Ray, Sharon, Zizi. I see Jessica. I see Huria, I see Don, I see Joe, I see Mabel, I see Henrietta, I see Danny, and I see a name that I cannot pronounce, but Rainforest Lynn, I see her, I see Fies, I see Alexis, I see Nidham, I see Alice, I see Tola, I see Chris, I see Virginia, I see Joseph, I see Wise Discerner, and I see Faith, and I see Tunuja and Cass, Brittany and Coco. I see Mary jumping in as well. I see you all. You all matter. Everyone in this room matters. Everyone in this world matters. We have to remind ourselves of that. So I first want to thank each and every one of you here for having taken your time to join us. To my moderators, I love you guys. Eleni, did I miss you?
You did miss me.
Yeah, because you weren't able. Yeah, you weren't able. I called on you, but. Okay, go ahead.
It's my phone. Hi, Eleni. I just wanted to wish you all the most incredibly blessed weekend. And to everybody down below, just enjoy the blessings. Stay in the day and know that abundance and magic is here for all of us.
Thank you, Eleni. We didn't purposely miss you. Oftentimes, your connection is so poor, we can't get you. So I'm glad that you were able to contribute. And once again, I just wanted to thank each and every one of my wonderful moderators for showing up and for being who you are and for sharing from the heart. You guys are amazing. Without you, I couldn't operate this room. And to each and every one of the speakers who came up, who showed their vulnerability, who shared their stories, asked their questions, or just shared some tips on how we can all get through this, I thank you as well.
to each and every one of the listeners here, thank you for giving your non-refundable gift. Yes, a gift of your time, because you make it happen as well. We all do. This is a room that I so believe in, and I get so much out of each and every week. And it's because of you and the contributions that you make that help enhance my life and make me move forward. I want to leave this world leaving something behind. As I said, we all have the opportunity to give and to leave something behind. So ask yourselves as the week goes on, what is it that I can give back to the world that the world will remember and will benefit from? And you'll be amazed what you can do. Sometimes it's just being that ear to listen to someone, inviting someone to speak, and just sharing your life story. Yes, being vulnerable. Because guess what? We are more similar than we are different. People across from us are having this life experience that we're having. We may think that we're alone in our struggles or in some of the adversities that have happened to us. But the moment that we become vulnerable, and vulnerability is not a dark emotion as so many people associate. A lot of people associate the pain and everything that has happened to them to this emotion called this vulnerability. But vulnerability is a beautiful thing because it connects us. And I see that my very good friend Glenn has joined us. Glenn, we're about to close the room, but we would love to hear from you if you have anything to share on how to get through this thing called life. We'd love to hear from you. You there, Glenn? Glenn may not be in a position to speak, but I'm so glad he dropped in. He always adds such value to the room. Jacqueline, did you want to say something or just applauding?
No, I'm just clapping for our friend Glenn.
Yeah, he's so great. And if you haven't followed Glenn, please do. He adds such great value to every room that he's in. You there?
Hey, Paul. Paul, I'm here. I'm getting used to this car. I just went out and bought myself a brand new beautiful car, and I'm not used to talking on Clubhouse via the car. I'm so old school. In fact, I'm so old school that when I was raised, we just called it school.
What? Oh, that's funny. What did you call the thing called school, the education place?
No, I'm saying we just called it school. It wasn't called old school back then.
Gotcha. All right.
Yeah, it was just school.
That took a little bit.
It's a little agedness humor is what that is.
Yeah, unfortunately, I got it, Glenn.
Yeah, I didn't.
Yeah, I know.
Right over my head.
But that joke has a target audience.
Let me ask you this. Did you have to climb like through 3 miles of snow uphill and back home to get to school?
No, I grew up in Texas. We didn't get the whole snow thing here. But, you know, I had a speaking engagement yesterday, Paul, and I was talking with the audience about the recipe nature of life, and that really and truly it comes down to beginning with finding value in your life, falling in love with your life, making a laundry list of what's beautiful about your life. And I will promise you, when you commit to doing that, you'll never run out of things to put down on that list. You'll never run out. Unless you're a broad strokes person who's in a hurry to get everything done right now, real quickly. But in the spirit of thoroughness, if you were to stop and say, I love the movement that my left toe, like my left big toe, gives me. I'm so grateful for salad. I'm so grateful for a crying baby. I'm so grateful for freedom. You know, we have this gratitude room here on Clubhouse, which is remarkable, but the concept of gratitude itself is hardly new. And it's interesting that when we practice gratitude, enough gratitude will eclipse any seeming challenge in our lives, because there is no point to worry. This is all going to tie into sabotage. There's no point to worry, because if you think about the worry chart, you know, is there something wrong in your life right now? Yes or no? No, well, then there's no point in worrying. Right off the bat, half of it is gone. Then the next question is there something wrong in your life? And this time you say yes. The next question is, can you do anything about it? If the answer is yes, then there's no need to worry. If when questioning yourself, can you do anything about it, the answer is no, then there's no need to worry. Rendering worry the most pointless activity available to us in this lifetime. Worry has zero value. Zero. No one has ever worried themselves back to greatness. It has never been an activity a doctor recommends. You know what? If you really want to get your life back on track, I can't recommend worrying highly enough. No doctor has ever said those words. So this all comes down to self-realization and self-love. And things like worrying begin to disappear and ultimately are eliminated from our lives when we understand the pointlessness of it. However, you have to be a committed prober. You have to be that in order to get the value of these understandings. You have to be willing to probe your life and say, you know, I'm going to treat my life as the science project that it is. Yes, it's a gift. It most assuredly is an assignment. You've heard me say that over the last few months. It's an assignment. Well, if you're going to turn in the assignment well, which is not done once in our lives, it's done daily. At the end of the day, we turn in our lives. That's here. My assignment today was to live beautifully. My assignment today was to live from a place of compassion and love and understanding. My assignment today was to listen. My assignment today was to help someone. My assignment today was to provide a laugh. My assignment today was to support a circumstance. My assignment today was to be a contributing presence in the world in every environment I'm in, period, with no exceptions. None of these things are too tall of a call for us to answer to. None of them, unless we decide they are. I find living life powerfully to be an absolute joy, and I consider it to be a privilege. And it wouldn't occur to me to harm the man I'm rooting for, which is me. Just as it wouldn't occur to me to harm anyone because I'm rooting for you. How can I, in the same breath, root for you, Paul, right? Or root for Michelle, or root for Jacqueline? I haven't even looked at who's on today, but any of the mods. How can I, in the same breath, root for you and then do something that harms you? Those modalities are like oil and water. They do not have any place together. So when we commit to love, anything that isn't that, by design, must go away. And sabotage would be one of those things. Increase your love, decrease your sabotage. Completely reside in love, eliminate your sabotage. I'm Glenn, and I'm done speaking.
I hope you're never done speaking, Glenn. That was powerful. Thank you so much for reminding us that we should be committed probers, and that gratitude should be one of the things that we exercise daily and even hourly, to be grateful for the things that we do have. Also, I love what you said about examining the things that we can't control. Asking yourself, is this something I can control? If so, I can do something about it. If it's something I can't control, no worries. I'll control whatever it is within my power.
Right. And in either event, Paul, worry has no place. Because if you think about it, if there's something that you can do to effect change, then there's no point in worry. I mean, there's never any point in worry. There really isn't. There's no valid argument for why someone should worry. You know, I really just feel very strongly I need to worry about this. Okay. Shed some more light on that. No one's going to ever come up with a valid reason for worry. But the problem is we've made worrying far too normal. And that's on us. As a society, we've made worrying a very, very normal thing to expect from human beings. And the problem is it is massively damaging. So
I don't know why we haven't evolved more than that as a species to consider the profound levels of damage that come about as a result of worry and encourage our kids to not give in to worry, no matter how common you see it to be. There's just no reason to ever worry. It doesn't contribute to life. It always causes angst. So there's just no value in it. And Paul, I want to say one more thing, and I'll be very brief about it. And the reason I want to mention this one thing of value is because, much to my surprise, yesterday when I was on stage, it's a 3-day event, and I'm speaking all 3 days. So I'm going back for my third and final stage outing today. But late last night, a group of us were sitting around, probably about 20 of us, and they were talking about these breakout groups, and one of the groups was devoted to asking one another what the biggest takeaways had been thus far in the seminar. And it was something that I had said. I'm not being boastful, I'm being just truthful in reporting, but it kind of blew me away. And what blew me away is that I didn't think that this would be insightful to people, but apparently it is, so it bears repeating. To me, this is an awareness I had when I was about 14, and I've lived my whole life based on it, but apparently this came as a novel concept to many people. And it's called putting yourself on the receiving end of your own behavior, which the only thing required to achieve that is to use your imagination, get outside of your body with your imagination, and right in the middle of some less than stellar behavior, just stop. Maybe it's a less than stellar tone of voice that does not reflect the love you feel for the person standing right in front of you. Once you learn how to disembody from your perspective and get out of your own body and stay, again, I'm not talking about physically doing this. I'm talking about doing it with your mind and walking over, say, 10 simple feet away from where you were when you used to only be in your body, and go stand over there and listen to how bad you sound. Listen to how unloving you sound. Listen to what it feels like, and feel what it feels like to be in your own midst. That's called placing yourself on the receiving end of you. Or how about going over 10 feet away and watching yourself mistreat yourself? What about standing outside of you and watching your treatment of you for one full day? Does it look like you are a valued possession? Are you treating yourself with kindness and love? And how about this one? Reverence? Do you revere this gift? And I'll close with this question. If you were to be charged with the crime of revering life, would there be enough evidence to convict you? I would hope so. I'm Glenn, and I'm done for now. Paul, thanks for letting me share. I didn't expect to share. I knew you guys were winding down, and I'm en route to go be a speaker, so I thought I'd hop on and just say I love you. So I love you. And Jacqueline, much love. Michelle, I don't see on the panel, but love to all of you that are listening, whether I've met you or not. The very best to you in your quest for excellence.
Thank you. Yeah, Michelle, go ahead, and I have something to add after you.
Yeah, I should say, love you, Glenn, and that just was so awesome to end with. You know, if you were charged with the crime of reverence, how could you stand that crime? You know, it's so great to be self-aware and to be a lover of life and to trust life, and that's like a main lesson I got out of what Glenn was saying. And Glenn, I just thank you for hopping on. And we love the new car because we can hear you as if we're sitting right next to you. It is amazing. So anyway, thank you so much for that. Mike, to you, Paul.
I got to love talking into the car receiver instead of into my cell phone. This is a brand new universe for me, you understand.
I do. It's cool.
It is great. And I just wanted to send back that love to you, Glenn. I love you very much. And thank you so much. I'm glad that you jumped on and that you contributed, because this room is all about taking something with us. And that was, we're not paying lots of money to see you today and to hear your wisdom, but we're benefiting from it. So I send you love and just go knock their socks off with some great new wisdom as well. So thank you so much for that. And we're going to just close off the room. And I think Michelle has a song that she would like to play as a closer. And we'll turn it over to her.
Here we go. This is just a song to just get us in the mood by one of my favorite artists on the planet. He's now in another dimension. But again, speaking to what Paul said, he left this legacy behind. So please listen to the words. Here we go.
Some of you young folks been saying, wonderful world. How about all them wars all over the place? You call them wonderful? And how about hunger and pollution? They ain't so wonderful either. But how about listening to old pops for a minute? Seems to me it ain't the world that's so bad, but what we are doing to it. And all I'm saying is, see what a wonderful world it would be if only we'd give it a chance. Love, baby, love. That's the secret. Yeah. If lots more of us loved each other, we'd solve lots more problems. And then this world would be a guesser. That's what old pops keep saying. I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them blue for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Thank you, everyone. Let's unmute and say our goodbyes. And thank you very much for joining us. And please do come back next week. And Glenn, thanks again for sharing. And have a wonderful afternoon. Go knock their socks off, brother. Bye, everyone.
Bye. Thank you, everyone.
Have a great day.
Have
a great week, all.
All right. Take care. Bye now.
Thanks for listening. Tune in next week for another insightful episode. If you haven't already, hit the subscribe button and leave your comments. For more information, check out our website at www.inspireus.ca. Remember, it's not what happens to us that matters most. It's how we respond to what happens to us that does. Stay strong and resilient. You're never alone. We're all in this together.